Philip Babiot. And just one little announcement, after the lecture, we'll have a kind of general picture for NES faculty and students. So please don't leave. And it will be a picture for the album, etc. So please don't leave after the lecture. We'll have a general picture. Okay, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Okay, thanks for being faithful to me. So today I will talk about, I will touch upon the debate on secular stagnation, but I will mainly talk about growth measurement. Okay, so the motivation comes, in fact, this picture is a bit incomplete, because in fact here it should go up to there, you see. So you see that's the history of TFP or labor productivity in the US, but you would have similar thing in other countries. So essentially, there is no growth worldwide up to 1820. Then you have the steam engine revolution, which takes you up to there. Then you have the electricity chemistry revolution. And this is the ICT revolution, maybe AI or whatever. And so I was making the joke that that would be like the attendance of my lectures. You see, yesterday was there, today it's here, and I hope that tomorrow is not there. No, I'm joking. It's a bad joke. It's, okay, so that's my you know, Jewish thing. It's the thing we make humor on. So Bob Gordon, who is a great colleague and who I'm sure you've read and know about, has this view that somehow growth, you know, had his heydays with the steam engine, essentially, and that things can only get worse and worse. So his view is that, you know, the steam engine revolution was the big thing. Then electricity and chemistry was okay. And then the ICT, we think it's a big deal, but it's not such a big deal. And if you, there are some people who reason in economic history by interpolation. You know, they believe that the future is just an extrapolation of the past, you know. I have even French colleagues who reason that way. I won't name them, but you might guess who I'm. They think you don't need theory to do economics. You just do, you don't just need a ruler. You don't need a ruler, and you don't need a theory. Why should we have a theory? You know, we just do a ruler, and tomorrow we know exactly what it will be. Okay, so if you follow that thing, this is it, quoi. I mean, growth was a nice experience. We humankind didn't have any Neanderthal, and most of sapiens, no growth, okay? And then we started growth in 1820. It was great fun, not for everybody, by the way, as we know. And then, you know, the whole thing is almost done. We are almost at zero growth. Voilà. And that's it. We are condemned. And then the Gordon's view is like, you know, innovation is like a fruit tree. You know, the best fruits is the one you get more easily. You see what I mean? And then you have to climb more, and the more you climb, the more you risk to fall down. And then the fruits you get are a bit bitter, you know, they're not so tasty. You see? That's the view of innovation, you see. No, I mean, I'm caricaturing, but I like to, let's have fun a bit. But it was very strange, is that the innovation has not, if you look at patent application and patent grants, but I could even have a citation weighted patents, they didn't decelerate in the US. They accelerated. And now you could say that patents is not just about innovation, it's about appropriation. But even if you restrict to cited patents, to highly cited patents, you have this acceleration. So it's very weird. How come we seem to find a kind of declining productivity growth and an accelerating patenting? Isn't there something going strange? Okay. And here is something that already is a kind of smoking gun that put us into suspicion. So here, what you have is that on the horizontal axis, I rank U.S. sectors in terms of how much creative destruction there is there, at how much churning, how much job creation and job destruction. Horty Wonger, you know, I do Horty Wonger there, and I see that. And so when I have sectors, I have two-digit sectors. The more I go to the right, the more creative destruction there is in the sector, okay? And the vertical axis is the correlation between TFP growth and the flow of patents annual. And I see that the more creative destruction there is, the less the lower the correlation between patterns and measured TFP growth. So in other words, it looks like, but of course I will go deeper, this is just smoking gun. It looks like when you have more creative destruction, you are less able to measure what innovation brings to TFP growth. In other words, the higher the rate of creative destruction, the less TFP growth seems to reflect innovation, the most mismeasured it seems to be. Okay, so what I will try to do now is to dig deeper into that. And then I will resume the debate on secular stagnation and tell you about my view on secular stagnation, and then we can have a discussion on that. Okay? And that's what I thought I would do today. Okay?
Excuse me.
Yes.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
I'm going to sort of sideline you a bit, so maybe you want you. Okay, I'm going to go ahead. So how do you feel about measuring innovation through patent application?
Oh, yeah. The thing is that the innovation, there are problems with that, is that, you know, you may capture appropriation only. And also there are many innovations that are not patented. We know about that. We know about that. But then you have other measures. You see, for example, you could have firm creation. Alors, I will tell you about that. And there are other measures which are not just patents. So I will get to your thing.
Okay. I'm just wondering, but I wanted to just put a reservation on the table, and I don't have an opinion. So which is, it looks like in the US, much of it, I don't know how much of it, but it seems that a lot of it is driven by the litigious culture in the US. So patents is basically also used by dredging your position.
No, of course, I know exactly what you're referring to. You refer to defensive patenting. We know a lot of patents are defensive to prevent entry also. But here you will see I have measures of innovation that are not just patents. So hold and I'll get back to you. Of course, you can imagine that for the past 30 years, these kind of things have... I will have measures of innovation that are not only patents. And you have ways to deal with that, which is the citation. But you have various ways. And you, whatever you do there is you try different things. When you see that the different things yield similar result, you know you are up to something. No single measure is perfect. But when you see that you have several measures and independent ways of doing things that yield similar results, then you feel that you are up to something. Okay, and I'll get back to you. Okay. That's my conclusion, but I go back to this. So I move to another file, and then I move back to this file later. So 1 second. Okay. So blah blah blah. Okay. View, full screen mode. Okay. Missing growth. Okay. That's where we are. So that's the picture I had. That's okay. That's another way to show my smoking gun. Here, instead of ranking sectors, I look at different years in the US, and I see that in years where you have, the years where I have more creative destruction are years where the rank correlation between TFP growth and patenting is lower. So here, instead of looking at sectors, I look at years. But you could also look at U.S. states or U.S. commuting zones, and you would have the same thing. Whenever you have more creative destruction, the correlation between patenting and productivity growth is lower. That was the smoking gun. That's the motivation. I will go to more things than patenting. You know, I will look at things other than patenting. Okay. So why should the contribution of innovation to TFP growth be more mismeasured in sectors with higher creative destruction? And the answer that I developed, and it's an idea that the idea I had when I was visiting Stockholm for almost 4 years ago, and I mentioned it 3 years ago, and I mentioned it. I mentioned it to Timo Popart, and then I told Timo, look, don't you think that'd be fun? And I mentioned that to Thorsten also, and then I said, well, look, maybe I will call Pete Klino, because Pete is a big specialist of empirical growth. If I can enroll Pete Klino into that, I win the game, because he's Mr. Empirical Growth, you see. And so and we formed now a team, a very good team with Pete. And so the answer there is that when creative destruction occurs and an item produced by a given seller has disappeared, the standard procedure is imputation. For each product category, imputation use price change of surviving products to infer the overall price change. And I will be very concrete, because now you think I'm speaking, I'm talking Chinese, and I will talk, as I said. That's the way to think about it. This is a bottle. Do you understand? So far, so good. Okay? Now, what we assume, which is a strong assumption, that the statistical office observes the monetary values of things. Okay? So they know the monetary, how many rubles this was worth yesterday, and how many rubles this is worth today. Okay? Suppose I make no change to the bottle between yesterday and today, and the value in rubles has increased. I know it's pure inflation. Okay? So far, you are with me? Okay, raise your hand, you're with me. That's the key to the whole thing, okay? Now, experiment number two. I keep essentially the same bottle, but I replace the tap by a tap a little bit nicer, although this one I like very much, but I say, suppose there is a slightly nicer tap, which I replace this one. And I see that the value in rubles changes between yesterday and today. Then more or less I can say that much is inflation, and that much is the real improvement in my bottle. But what happens if I replace my bottle by this? The statistical office has no clue. So what they do is that for any category of products, that's not a great example, so these two will not be in the same category of products, suppose they were, they will calculate the inflation rate by restricting attention to products that were there yesterday and today. And what they will do, they will say, well, I will assume that this inflation rate applies to the whole category of products, including those that have been replaced. And that's where they are making a mistake, because they will overstate inflation and understate growth. Typically, the new products will be better than the old one. And they will think it's just inflation, when in fact it was a quality improvement that they are missing. That's the whole story. So if you want to know in another way, let me look at this example, okay? Numerical example. Suppose that I have 100% of items. 80% are like my bottle, I didn't make any change. So there is no innovation, and suppose there is 4% inflation. Inflation is the increase in quality adjusted price. But here it's the same as saying the increase in the price, because on these items there was no quality improvement. Suppose on 10% of the items there was a quality improvement, but it was more like the thing where I changed the tap. You see what I mean? A kind of incremental innovation made by the incumbent. And suppose as a result the quality adjusted price goes down by 6%. There is a quality improvement, and therefore price over quality goes down. Okay? And suppose that 10% of the items is this creative destruction, the bottle replaced by this. And again, as a result, there is minus 6% increase in quality adjusted price. And suppose that the true inflation is 2% at the aggregate, and the true real growth is 2%. So the true nominal growth will be 2 plus 2, which is 4%. You understand that? The true nominal growth will be 4%. Okay? But how this 4% decomposes into true real growth and inflation, the statistical office will miscalculate it. It should have calculated 2 and 2, but it will not do that. Because when the statistical office will compute inflation, they will ignore these goods. Let's say they don't exist. They will just base themselves on the goods that were yesterday and today. And they will say 80 over 80 plus 10, which is 8 over 9, had 4% inflation. 10 over 80 plus 10, which is 1/9, they had minus 6%. And they will infer, they will say the inflation rate was 2.9. But they know that the true nominal growth was 4. So they will say, well, what is the measured growth, the true growth? It is 4 minus 2.9. And they will say that the true real growth is 1.1, when the true real growth was in fact 2. And therefore they missed 0.9 of growth. You understand? That's the whole paper. If you understood that, you understand the lecture. Who did not understand that? Who understood that? Who is not sure? We can go back. Tell me.
No.
Okay. So that's what we are trying to do. Okay. So my presentation will be on two papers. One is a paper with Antonin Bergeot, Timo Bopard, Pete Clino, and Yui Li, which is a revised resubmit for the American Economic Review. And one is the Missing Growth and Farm Dynamics, which is a paper that, in fact, I used for my presidential address at the EEA in Lisbon, and it's coming out in the JEA, okay? And so I'm done with the introduction. I will start with the model. I will just sketch the model, okay? So it's a very simple Schumpeterian growth model, but really in discrete time. So I assume that time is discrete, and each period, the economy is populated by a mass of identical one-period lived individuals who consume a finite good. So the finite good, Y, is produced with a continuum of intermediate inputs. You see what I mean? And Q omega is the quality of intermediate input Y omega in producing the final good. Okay? And sigma is the elasticity of substitution between the intermediate inputs. If sigma was infinity there, they would be completely substitutable. Okay? Okay? So that's the final good. So usually in growth models, what you have is that you say, well, the final good sector is competitive. So each intermediate good product is paid its marginal product in producing the final good. But the intermediate good sectors are monopolistic because, in fact, there are innovation. And when you have a better way to produce, when you produce an intermediate input of higher quality, you have monopoly rents until someone else comes and replaces you. Okay? So I will not be very far. So in fact, I will assume that each intermediate input here is produced one for one, one unit for one unit with labor. So I will say Y omega equal L omega, okay? And if because the final good sector is competitive, each intermediate good is paid its marginal productivity in producing the final good, then you can solve for profit maximization by each intermediate producer, and you will find that P omega, which is the price of the intermediate good, is a markup over the wage. Okay, and the markup, if there is no competitive fringe, depends, it's just sigma over sigma minus one. Okay, that's what you are. You solve for that. Usually in Schumpeterian models, that's the last stage. Then you go back, you do backward induction, and you solve for the optimal R&D. But here I will make it trivial. I will assume exogenously, I will assume that the arrival rate of innovation is exogenous. Okay, so I will assume that there are three types of that growth in this model comes from three types of innovation. So there will be innovation that improves the quality Q omega, and there will be innovation that expands variety. That means that increases capital N here. Okay, so I will assume that at an arrival rate in any sector omega, at an arrival rate lambda d, there is a new guy who replaces the current guy, and he produces a good which is gamma d times better. You see? Then in sectors where you don't have creative destruction, I will assume that still with an arrival rate lambda I, the incumbent makes an improvement. It's like my tap that I change, you know, to my bottle. So the first thing is my bottle replaced by the flag. The second one is the tap replacing the bottle, and I assume that that happens at an arrival rate lambda I if there's not been creative destruction, and in that case the good I improve by gamma I. Okay, and finally I allow for new variety. You can expand variety at an arrival rate lambda n. New inputs can come in, and I assume they have gamma n better than the existing inputs on average. Okay. And those are the source of growth. Usually, when you solve an endogenous growth model, you endogenize the lambdas. You solve for the optimal R&D, which will give you the lambdas. Here, I don't do that. So it's a very super simple endogenous growth model, which is not fully endogenous. You see what I mean? Okay? And now, what I want to compute missing growth there. So you see, the thing is as follows. I know that you can calculate monetary value. So the monetary output is M equal PY. Y is the real output. P is the aggregate price. Okay, which is in fact also a CES function in that case. Okay. So now it means that YT plus one over YT is equal to MT plus one over MT. Divided by PT plus 1 over PT. This I know how to calculate. This is okay. This is what I do not know how to calculate. So the missing growth will come from the fact that you don't know how to compute the inflation rate. And it's exactly the story I told you with the numbers. Okay? So, in fact, what will happen is that you see the log, the missing growth is the log of yt plus 1 over yt. Is that clear that it's the log? Okay, the log of yt plus over yt is in continuous time, the growth rate is y dot over y, which is a derivative with respect to t to log of y of t. Everybody here should be no problem in Russia. Huh? You taught us all that, okay? We all learned from Kolmogorov and all the Russian mathematicians, okay? Okay. So, and that is equal, therefore, given this, to log of the estimated inflation rate minus the log of the true inflation rate. But now, why is there a mistake in inflation rate? Because, in fact, I will assume that the statistical office, they correctly measure the growth due to incumbent innovation, but they miss the new varieties, and they miss the creative destruction. So as a result, you see, the true output growth is this, but the statistical office, they will forget the new variety. And whenever there is creative destruction, they will think that the growth rate involved is the same growth rate as when you have no creative destruction, which is this growth rate. So they will think that there is not this, and that you have lambda d times this lambda I, gamma I to the sigma minus 1 minus 1. As a result, they will find this growth. You see what I mean? And therefore, you have this expression of the missing growth. Missing growth is just this, and you can see that if you had no arrival of new products, if you had new lambda n was zero, and you had no creative destruction, you had log of one, and log of one is zero, and you would have a missing growth of zero. But what's very nice with this formula is you can express missing growth as a function of the amount of new varieties and the amount of creative destruction in the economy. Okay? But in fact, I will first introduce a method that, so if you wanted, ideally you would have, and that will come to your question, you should estimate what is lambda n, what is lambda d, and what are the gammas. And you would need a method to estimate the lambdas and the gammas. That's difficult to do. I will get back to that later. But it turns out that you don't need to do that. You can bypass that to calculate missing growth. And I will show you a first method. And the method I will show you is the following. It uses market shares. In fact, what I do with the statistical of it does is that it concentrates on people who existed yesterday and today. I abstract from people who were not there yesterday. You see what I mean? So you calculate the growth corresponding to the continuers, to the survivors. So in fact, suppose that the growth of the survivors would be the same as the growth of the overall economy. In that case, there would be no missing growth. But in that case, it would mean that the market share of the survivors would remain the same. They would remain equally important. So in other words, if there is no growth in the market share of survivors, there will be no missing growth. That's exactly the method. And in fact, the beauty is when you have a CES function, you can express the like this. You can say, well, the missing growth is in fact proportional to the log of the market share of the survivors last period divided by the market share of the survivors today. Suppose, for example, that the market share is the same yesterday and today, but then this log would be zero, and you would have no missing growth. Suppose that the survivors, I call IT, the employment share of all the firms that were there yesterday and today. Suppose that their share declined. That means that SITT minus 1 is bigger than SITT. If the market share declined, it means that they grew less than the overall economy. So if I focus on them, I miss some growth. And that's exactly what this expression tells you. If SITT minus 1 is bigger than SITT, I have positive missing growth. But if their market share was growing over time, I would have negative missing growth. You see? You understand? So what we do here, because we don't have data on products, except for very few products, we identify a product with a plant. You know that firms have multiple plants. When I did Clété Cortum, each new product is a plant. Now it's true that plants have varying number of products over time, but after 5 years, usually they stabilize their number of products. So I will take plants in the mature version, when the number of products per plant doesn't change much. So to implement this method on US data, because I don't have exhaustive data on products directly, I assume that you have a constant number of products per plant. But I look at plants in their mature version, which is a very good approximation, okay? So that's what I will do. So intuitively, by the way, true growth will exceed measured growth whenever the market share of continuing incumbents shrinks over time. Intuitively, the difference between true growth and measured growth is equal to the difference between true growth and incumbent average productivity growth. The market share of incumbents shrinks whenever the average productivity of survivors grows more slowly than the average productivity of the economy as a whole. Okay? So now how do we implement that? But I will try to proxy for the SIT T minus 1 divided by SIT T. So I will use either employment or payroll. Let's start with employment. So SIT T minus 1, it's the, I will denote, I will use this notation. LT B less than B, D less than D, is the employment at time T of people born before small b, and dying and death after small d. You see what I mean? That's the way I will denote. So a survivor between t minus 1 and t, someone was born before t minus 1 and dies after t. And I look at the employment at t minus 1. I divide this employment by this employment plus the employment of the exiters at t minus 1. You have the employment share of the survivors. What is the employment share of the survivors? Is their employment divided by their employment plus those who are not survivors? And those are the exiters, okay? Now, that's the SIT T minus 1, this whole thing. Then you have the SIT T. What is SIT T? Is the employment share of the survivors at time T. So it's at time T, now you will look at time T. And the survivors are again those who are born before T minus 1 who die after T. Is the employment at time T divided by that employment plus the employment of the new arrival, the newcomers, the new entrants at time T. And that's the SITT. You see what I mean? And I use data. So now the thing is, how do you look at plants? What do you take for the B? What kind of value you take for T? Quoi? And so we do the analysis first US. We use the longitudinal business database, which covers all plants with at least one employee. And we will focus on 83-2013 because we will take plants of at least 5 years old. Why? Because plants at the beginning, they stabilize. They take time, you see, to build capital, hire and train workers, accumulate customers. So we will take the year that they will appear for us. It's 5 years after they appear in the statistics, you see, because we think that at the beginning, they are not stable. We want to look at your potential. You see, your contribution to inflation is really what your potential is. If you turn out that you will make a big hit, we want to take that into account right away. You see what I mean? We don't want that to wait. We take that. You see, we abstract from the early period. And you can see here, this is the employment growth. But you could see also, you would do the same with the number of products growth in a plant. You see that after 5 years, you are below 0.05% of growth. You are essentially, so at the beginning, you have some employment growth, but then you stabilize. And that's why we take, 5 years. But you could take 3 years. IT Wonger prefers 3. Of course, we look at what happens if you take 0 years. But we think that 5 years is reasonable. Because then, plants stop growing. And they really, what we capture is the contribution of the plant to the product, to the inflation rate, to the aggregate, productivity adjusted price. You see what I mean? And so we look at the true quality that you represent, and the true quality is what you end up being, it's not what you are at the very beginning. Okay. So we do that, and we take sigma equal 4 based on various papers that have looked at sigma, but you can be more precise on sigma. There are some micro studies who can derive sigma for some, some sectors, and you can do much more micro work on sigma, and we are doing that in the revision. But we remain in the same ballpark. So you see, because the sigma, you could look at sigma locally, and you can really get into the sigma. But what's very nice is that the estimates we get, taking sigma equal 4 and k and 5 years, and we take plants 5 years after they appear in the statistics to really look at them, we see that what's very interesting, that the missing growth doesn't decline over time, and it's even bigger in the later period. And then I can look at the measured growth. That was the measured productivity growth in the US. And you see that as a fraction of the total growth, missing growth has gone up. So there's been a declining productivity growth. But what you can see is that in the decline here, 10% of that decline is due to mismeasurement. You still have a decline when you correct for the missing growth. But you are well above. That's productivity growth. You see, the productivity growth rate in the US is way above what was estimated. That's an average per year. These numbers are year average over this period. You see what I mean? You are, the US grow at least at 0.75 or 0.7 above what is claimed. You see, that's productivity growth. To that you add the growth in factors, you know, and you have the decomposition of growth into capital growth, labor growth, alpha k dot over k plus one minus alpha l dot over l plus the solo residual. All what I'm showing here is the solo residual, but what you see is by how much you are underestimating the solo residual just because you are not measuring inflation correctly due to creative destruction. It's just that one source that I isolate. It's not supposed to be the entire mismeasurement. It's just that reason gives you that much mismeasurement. And you see, my response already to Gordon is I tell Gordon, if you have 172 productivity growth annual average over since the crisis, it means that total growth is around 2.5. I don't call that stagnation. There is secular, but there is no stagnation at 172. And in fact, which means the total growth of 2.5, you are not at stagnation, you are above. Now it's true that you had a decline, which we still need to explain, but you are well above. So if the wave was there, you are still above, there is something like this. Since 2006, it's true, 2013, it's true that the growth rate has gone down, but we say that we are above. In fact, we are even less. We've gone like that. You see what I mean? The gap has gone up. So you are still a decline, but it's not stagnation. We are well above what he said. Okay? You understand? Oh, I'm losing my microphone. Where do I put it? Can you help me? Yeah. That's very good. Thank you. Okay, very good. And I should now. This goes mad. I should view full screen mode. Okay. So. Now you can try, you know, you can try all kinds of things. You can imagine since 3 years, and with the referees, they ask us all kinds of things, and we do. So you can look at different sigmas, you can look at payroll instead of employment to measure market share, and you get similar measures. You can also look, instead of looking at the economy as a whole, as we did, you can look by sector. So you can divide sectors in one digit, the economy in one digit sectors, and then you can say sigma equal 4 within sectors, but you take Cobb Douglas across sectors, you get 0.64 over the period 83-2013. If you do that by dividing the economy in two-digit sectors, you get this at 3. If you divide it in 3-digit, you do sigma equal 4 within and Cobb Douglas across, you get this number. But you see, it's very, very stable. You remain always in the same path. How much, no matter how much you divide your economy. So that's kind of a robustness test already. Of what you are doing. You can look at sectors, you know, at the one digit. And what's very interesting is that manufacturing accounts for a very small share of the missing growth. It's because you had a decline in the manufacturing sector in the US. A lot comes from services. Most of it is services. Very little is from manufacturing in the US. And here, it's very interesting. That's like my smoking gun, but now it's more precise. Here, what I do is that I look at the correlation between a measure of creative destruction. Here I look at annual net entry rate. So net entry is entry minus exit, okay? But you could look at, so that's annual entry rate in the sector, and then you have the percentage points of missing growth, and it's across two-digit sectors in the US, and you see this very clear correlation. But I could have put creative destruction as a measure, churning as a measure that I put in the horizontal axis. I would get very similar things. Wherever you have more creative destruction, you have more missing growth. Okay. So now that's the first method that I used. Okay. the method I used didn't use the lambdas and the gammas. I looked directly at the evolution of the market share of survivors. But now you can go back to the formula that I had before, which was this formula. Okay, and I could directly try to estimate the lambdas and the gammas. And there's been a recent paper by Garcia Macia, Clino, and Say, which in data from the longitudinal business database, and they compute average TFP growth, exit rate by of firms by age, employment of firms by age, job destruction, job creation. They look at firm level, they don't look at plant level. But from that, they infer lambdas and gammas. You see what I mean? But the problem is that typically when you do growth, for example, if you do growth with Cobb-Douglas type of function, I got it in my paper with Howitt, you would get G equal lambda log of gamma. You see, this kind of thing. So if you observe the G and you observe somehow the lambda, you would deduce the gamma. You see what I mean? You would use that. But they use, of course, the measured growth. So what we did is to adapt their methodology to take into account the fact that you are missing growth. So what we do is that we do as follows. We adapt their technology. We start from an assumed true growth. And from there, and the data on firm exit rates of by age, employment by age, creative destruction, blah, 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 blah. And from an assumed total growth, I derive lambdas and gammas. When I derive lambdas and gammas, it will give me a value for measured growth. You remember that I had my measured growth expression. The lambda, the y t plus 1 over y t hat. So I would deduce a measure of measure 1, I would compare to the growth I truly measure. If it's the same, I am done, I was right. If it's not the same, I start from a different assumed total growth. And then I go back and I see whether I get the measure growth, which is the actual growth I measure. You see what I mean? There is a predicted measure of growth and the actual measured growth. And I go until I get to a U star such that the measured growth I predict is the actual measured growth. And then the missing growth is just my G U star minus the measured growth I arrived at. And you calculate missing growth. But the nice thing with this method, you don't need to assume that creative destruction and new variety comes from new plants. You don't need to assume a constant number of product per plant. And in addition, you can compute the lambdas and gammas, and therefore you can decompose the missing growth into their creative destruction and new variety components. And that's what we do. And what's very nice is that you find that like very much in the same ballpark as when we did the market share. You find that about 40% and 30%, and for the later period, 30% of growth is missed, which is exactly what we found before. And the nice thing we also find is that 80% of the missing growth is creative destruction. Only a fourth of it is new variety. We gave a chance to new variety, but 80% of the missing growth is creative destruction, okay? So that's the thing. And now what we need is to do it in France, but you could do it in Russia. You know, people now are replicating, they are doing it in Italy. Francesca Lotti is doing it at the Bank of Italy. Someone is doing it at IFS for England. Someone is doing it for Sweden. You see, someone is doing it for Japan. So it would be very interesting to look at missing growth here in Russia. And in France, we have firm-level data, very detailed, and we have data on establishments and firms. We know the location of establishment, date of registration, the size of the workforce. We know, as in the US, that after 5 years, the employment growth is essentially at zero, so we can do the market share approach, taking k equal 5, even k equal 3 would do it, okay? And we can measure employment either by the headcount on December 31st, which is what they do in the US, or you can use full-time equivalent. When you're half-time employed, you count one half. You see what I mean? And you can use payroll, you can use value-added, you can use hours, and those are the average yearly missing growth you get for France over the period 2004-2015, okay? And it's very much in the same order of magnitude as the US. It's very interesting, yeah? And very different data, and you get to very similar, you know, estimates, okay? And you can look at different Ks, different sigmas, and you see the thing that very, very little. And you can look at different sectors in France, and usually where you have more creative destruction, you have more missing growth, you see. That's again, you find the broadly correlation in terms of sectors between creative destruction and missing growth. This is geography. I don't know if you've been to France, this Riviera. There is a lot of missing growth there. There is very little in the east of France. The east of France is a big cemetery. You know, there's something called the World War. You know about that too. And with two World Wars, especially the first one, it turned the east of France into a big cemetery. So there is no missing growth because there is no growth, essentially. You see, that's terrible. Anyway, you should visit the east of France. It's a huge cemetery. Here you have the département. You know, France is divided. Napoleon came and divided France into departments. And the department where you have more creative destruction, you have more missing growth. And the other thing is that you can compare between US and France. And you see that if you use head counts in both countries, you can see that the missing growth is not very different between US and France, particularly between 2006-2013. It's a little bit lower in France than in the US, although it's a higher fraction of total growth. In France, in fact, a higher share of productivity growth is missed. But of course, productivity growth is lower in France than it is in the US. So we have a lower missing growth, but as a fraction of total productivity growth, missing growth is higher in France. But it's very similar to US. Now you could think that everything is similar between France and US. No, those are very different countries. And the question is the firm dynamics the same between the two? And in fact, it's not the same. And that's the tilt, the twist here is this. You see, the thing is as follows. You see, remember that my formula for missing growth is this. You remember the market share of survivors at time t divided by the market share at time t plus 1. But what is the market share? You know, I have total employment is the employment of the survivors. Alors here I did between t and t plus 1 instead of minus t, between t minus 1 and t. Okay? It's the same thing. So here is the employment, total employment at time t is the employment of the survivors plus the exiters' employment. Employment at t plus 1 is the employment of the survivors at t plus 1 plus the employment of the new entrants. So this is SITT is just XT over LT. SITT plus 1 is just XT plus 1 over T plus 1. But I can now, I just replace, you see, and L. I know what L is. You see, I mean, L is X plus T. So XT over LT is 1 minus LT minus ET over LT. So it's 1 minus ET over LT. This is 1 minus FT over LT plus 1. If those numbers are small, this log is approximately equal to this. And you can see that the missing growth is approximately equal to the employment share of the new entrants tomorrow minus the employment share of the exiters yesterday. You see what I mean? But today minus yesterday, not tomorrow. You see what I mean? You understand what I mean? It's the employment of the entrants next period minus the employment share of the exiters last period, okay? Now, the thing is, what's very interesting is that in France, you see both the employment share of, oh, I've done the stupid thing I shouldn't have done. And then we go back to the view, 1 second. You see, what's very interesting is that in France, the employment share of the entrants is much higher than in the US. The employment share of the exiters is much higher in the US. But because it's the difference that matters, you get missing groups that are very similar. But the underlying dynamics is different in France and the US. And why is it that the employment share of new entrants and new exiters is bigger in the France than in the US? Because of this, you see, in France you have startups, but they don't grow much and they disappear quickly. Whereas in the US, very good firms survive long, so they get a higher employment share. So the employment share of entrants and new firms is bigger in France than in the US. Because when you are very good in the US, you survive and you grow more and you are selected more. You remember my selection yesterday? It's linked to that. And in fact, you can see that here. Here is the employment of plants, but you would have similar thing of firms. You see, in the US, you grow, when you are good, you grow more. You see, with age, those who survive very long, they typically tend to be higher. You see that there is a selection, better selection in favor of the very good ones than you have in France. So that's why the employment share of the young is bigger in France. Because in France, even if you're very good, you don't grow much. You see? Now, what about exiters? Exiters, well, we know, and that was a prediction of the Clété-Cortoum model yesterday. You remember what I told you about Clété-Cortoum? The employment share, the small firms exit more than the large firms. The young exit more than the old. You remember? Because the young, they were one line or two lines. The old have more, many lines. It's the exit rate is smaller. So I know that in general, both true in US and France, the exit rate is bigger for young than old. But the young represent a higher share of employment in France than in the US. That's why also the employment share of exiters is higher in France than in the US. So both the employment share of entrants and the employment share of exiters is bigger in France than in the US. You see? And that explains why you have this comparison, why you have this greater than this and this greater than this. But the difference cancels out a bit, you see? And you find similar missing growth, but behind you have different firm dynamics. Okay. So conclusion, the missing growth from what I call imputation, you see, the imputation is the fact that you only focus on survivors when you calculate the inflation rate, and it's about 0.6% on average per year in the US, 0.5% on average in France. About one-fourth, one-third of growth, of productivity growth is missed in the US. About one-half of productivity growth is missed in France. What you could improve, you see, for example, of course, ideally, you would like to collect data on market shares of incoming and outgoing products and estimate the substitutability, estimate the sigma. But you need to know the market share when they are mature. See, that's what the statistical office doesn't know, because you need to wait until they're 5 years old to know what they become, or you need to anticipate what they will become. Yeah, ideally, you would like that. You would like to be able to anticipate what the market share will be and to estimate the sigma. That's difficult to do. But already something they could do to improve is to base imputation only on those surviving products which innovate. The surviving that don't innovate, you should at least not count them when you do the imputation. That would already correct a little bit, okay? So now, why should we care about this? We should care about this because, for example, when we set inflation target, you know, the Bundesbank, they are obsessed by inflation, because in 1930s, Germany had hyperinflation. They were traumatized by that. Since then, you know, they have an illness called obsession with hyperinflation. And the problem is that, you know, you have to explain to them, look, you know, you overestimate inflation. It's at least 0.7 lower than what you think. So even we probably had deflation in the latest period. So your obsession of the central bank should be growth as much as inflation, but not just inflation, because it's even lower than what you think it is. So that, I think, is one consequence. Another thing is that when you do growth policy like R&D, taxation, other policies to induce growth, with the problem is that we don't know how to measure correctly the growth effect, because the rate is growth measurement problem. You should correct for the mismeasurement before you do welfare analysis of growth policies. Okay. So now let me go back to back to Gordon. Did we explain the secular stagnation? No, we didn't. We explained 10%. It's true that because of mismeasurement, it's 10% of the secular stagnation is explained. But still, what I can tell Gordon is that we are way above. We don't have stagnation. We have secular. So secular, yes, but don't use the word stagnation. When you have a growth rate in the US, productivity growth of 172 over the worst period per year, and which is 2.5 of total growth, you don't have stagnation. You have secular. You may still want to explain secular. And let me just go there back to my first set of slides, and then I will conclude. I will conclude that way. 1 second. Okay, so let me just go there. Okay, anime slideshow. Okay, so let me talk about the secular stagnation. So all that was my previous concluding section, so that we fit. And let me know about secular stagnation. So explaining it, well, you know, as I said, missing growth from imputation accounts for only 10% of the decline in measured productivity growth over the period 2006-2013. Other candidates, well, You know, there are other sources of increasing mismeasurement. For example, free access on price quality improvements, increased globalization. Let me be more precise. On free access, Wikipedia, blogs, YouTube, all these are free and unpriced, but they increase your utils. So that's something we don't measure, okay? Another thing is that there are goods that have improved on consumer side, and it's not measured in the GDP. Photos, for example. In 2000, 80 billion photos were taken worldwide. In 2015, 1,600 billion photos, 20 times more. But the cost of producing a photo picture went from half a euro to zero, essentially. Okay, so that's when you had the analog system, then you had the digital, and now you have iPhone. Now it's iPhones that you use to take pictures, which costs absolutely nothing. Okay, and that was the processing. You see, so when you had the film, you had to buy the pellicule, the film, and then you had to process for the photos. Then when I was a child, it was even higher, no? And then when you had the numeric, the digital, and then it went down to almost to zero, you see, with the iPhone. And that's what you spend now on making a photo. But still, you have a service which is given there. It's unpriced. So that's also missing growth there that I haven't talked about, you see? So that's one thing. There is another third reason, which is that you have, of course, globalization. For example, Apple has suppliers from 28 countries, and you assemble from 28 countries. In California, you do the design, software, marketing. In China, you do the assembling, and you don't know very well what to allocate to. You see what I mean? So you have a measurement problem there that comes from the globalized nature of the value chain, which is an additional problem. But that's independent of what I've done, abstracted from that. So, and also I assume that the incumbent innovation are perfectly measured, the lambda I and the gamma I. But in fact, Broda and Weinstein would tell you that even that is not well done. So my missing growth is underestimating the total missing growth. It's certainly higher than what I did. I just took one source of missing growth, but we think that it's bigger than that, okay? Now, finally, I would like to go back to the debate on the secular stagnation. Okay, so I said already, well, there are other sources of missing growth that we may want to explore. But even assuming that is not the mismeasurement, you could have things that could explain. So, for example, Chad Jones, Nick Loon, Van Rinen, and a fourth co-author had a paper called New Ideas Harder to Find. And they try to argue that new ideas are harder to find. That might be another reason for a secular stagnation. I am a bit doubtful. I like their paper. It's true that you always run into decreasing return on particular lines, but you always find new lines that you explore. So that's why I don't fully agree. I don't think it was a nice try, but I don't think most of it comes from there. I don't see why things are harder. I even think that it's easier to do research nowadays. I mean, now I can Skype every day. I can Dropbox. It's much easier to collaborate than it was before. I think the IT revolution and the AI revolution affect not only the production of goods and services, but it affects the production of ideas. And I have a survey with Jones, by the way, and with Ben Jones and Chad Jones. I'm the only one not called Jones in the set of authors. And we think that there, you see, we don't take that into account. So the ideas are harder to find. I don't quite buy personally. I like the paper, but I'm not sure that's the explanation. There is another explanation, end of Cold War. You see, what was very helpful for the US was to exaggerate the Soviet force strength, you see? I think the CIA people were very good at exaggerating the Soviet threat and saying there was much bigger to make them do more. But it's a very interesting thing, by the way. I didn't mention that yesterday. If you look at innovation, I will say something very crazy here, but of course, Soviet Union and Russia have been a country of great innovation in one area particularly, defense and space. Why? Because there they had competition with the US and they were innovating to escape competition. It was exactly my model of yesterday. Why did you have innovation in that sector? Because it was the only sector where you had competition and you had to innovate. You were racing with the US, but they were racing with you too. And during the Cold War, they created NASA, they created NIH, they created the NSF, the National Science Foundation. Now that the Cold War is over, they fall asleep. You see what I mean? They do much less. That might be a reason as well. The problem is how quantitatively important it is. And there is another one that I'm exploring, is the declining competition. There is this view that the innovators of yesterday, like the GAFAs, you know, like Facebook, and they become entrenched firms, entrenched, and they have network effects. So you have like entrenched incumbents with network effects. So they accumulate the network effects and the entrenched, and they become a barrier to new innovation. And I'm trying to explore. There have been evidence that a concentration of market share has gone up. There have been a very interesting paper by Autor, Katz, Dorn, Van Rienen, and someone else on that. They've been worked by, you know, Delocker and the co-author, boom. And there have been another paper by Philippon and the co-author, and Gutierrez. And all these papers point at the concentration of market share and concentration of markup in the US. But I believe at the same time, this decreasing competition has gone along with reduction in productivity growth. And I think it's very much, again, the Schumpeterian story that you had at the turn of the 20th century. In the 19th century, you had the big guys who did the Industrial Revolution. They became entrenched incumbents, and they put barriers to, and that's why you had that decline. Olson and Mokyr argue, in particular, that that was one reason why you had a decline in productivity growth at the turn of the century. Maybe we have the same story, plus the network effect, worse than before, because the GAFAs have the network effect on top. So that's why I'm currently exploring with Clino and the same team of people there, okay? And those, that's where we are, but we are now trying to find what are the main reasons behind. Do I believe that that will last forever? No, I think eventually it won't last. You will have big new waves. There are big new discoveries to be made in health, in renewable energies. We know that there will be big discoveries to be made. And so that's why I'm much more optimistic than Gordon can be. And that's where we stand. But this is research in progress to try to find what is the main explanation of the observed recent decline in productivity growth. I believe that the reduction in competition and network effects is the one I take most seriously. I think there might be the end of Cold War effect a little bit, but I think mostly the other one. But that's, I am currently working on it, so I'll tell you when it's done. Well, and I think that concludes what I wanted to say. Thank you.
Okay, so we have time for questions.
Okay, let me start. What is it about increasing financial misallocation?
Alors, this is another story, is the fact that, in fact, you see that the story there is that credit has become more relaxed, interest rate went down, and because interest rate went down, that allows less efficient firms to remain. So it's very much based on what we did yesterday. You see, remember yesterday the Crédit Cortum or the selection, the idea that selection would have worsened a bit as a result of the decline in interest rates. For example, it has been worked by Gita Gopinath and Sebnem, I never know her last name, but you would know the last name of Sebnem. No, Sebnem Oskan, you know, she's from Turkey. She's at Maryland. Oh God, she has a compounded name. They argue that, you know, you had increased misallocation due to credit, but they don't look at growth. But I think there might be something like that. And there are colleagues of mine from France that look at the fact that interest rate going down might have allowed less efficient firm to remain more. I don't know how important that is. Voilà. That's another candidate. That will explain why, since the crisis particularly, you would have that problem. Because after the crisis, interest rate went down more. The, you know, you had easy money, you know, quantity easing and all that. Might have worsened the selection process. So that's this equation. That's also one which we people are looking at.
Yes.
Yeah,
I have a question in relation to what you were saying yesterday. What would be the implication of the missing growth measurement for the countries that are not on the technological frontier, say the kind of growth point limitation? So I guess you would have like less.
Presumably, you would have less missing growth.
Yeah.
From that source, but you could have other type of missing growth. But from that source, you would have less.
Right.
And secular stagnation, I would look more towards the middle income trap than this kind of explanation. Although middle income trap had to do with lack of competition as well.
Yeah.
But I would look more there. But for example, Russia, I think in Russia, I would say something very stupid, but what comes to mind is the combination of the resource curse and the oligarchs.
Yeah.
That's obviously a first order. I mean, I'm provocative here. It must play a role, no? And one worse than the other, both go towards against competition. And also in Russia, my concern is the fact that, I don't know about PISA tests, but we know that education, good quality education, alors you have the new economic school, which goes the other way, it's fantastic, but I don't know about PISA tests. I know that one of the good things, because you know I've been very sympathetic to Soviet Union and all that in my youth, and so I know one good thing I used to praise the Soviet Union and socialist bloc was education. You had a first quality education. What's happened to education in your country? Have you looked at the evolution of PISA tests and all that? My fear was that you would destroy the good thing you had. I mean, preserve and improve education, for God's sake. That's so important. But I don't know. You know better than me. Yes?
I'm wondering, so typically when we think about antitrust, I don't think that, in summary, but I have the impression that they tend to make more of a static thing of consumers and so on.
Yeah, exactly.
Incentives for innovation.
Yeah.
Is there any movement towards including these kinds of considerations?
Now, there is, I mentioned the trade stuff yesterday. So that goes in that direction. It's true before, at the very beginning, people were just concerned about consumer surplus. Yep. It's good to have competition because consumer surplus goes up. But then more and more they look at dynamics. In fact, some people had already looked a bit at dynamics, and it was Scherer. You see, Scherer already in the 60s had started, late 50s, early 60s. But in the way, Scherer was a bit isolated. There were not many people like Scherer. And in fact, really, we took back that when with my friends in the early 90s. And now people in trade are looking at that, and that's a good development, but it's very recent. But it's true, to be fair, you had some people who had looked at that, at Gilbert and other people in I.O. But in I.O. it was no more. See, the problem with I.O. is that there is one effect going this way, there is one effect going that way, and you would count how many effects that way, how many effects this way, and that's how you would say it dominates there. You would never know when one effect dominates the other. With the inverted U work, We were able to say that's where the effect A dominates, that's where the effect B dominates, you see? But you have to do the empirics and the composition effect. That's what the I.O. people were not doing, you see what I mean? So they were also concerned. I mean, you had Dasgupta, Stiglitz, who had done some work, you see what I mean? You had precursors, but they never quantified. Voilà, to be totally honest. And there is a nice survey by my friend Xavier Vives on competition, but there is no quantification there, you see what I mean? You know,
and in terms of like actual like policy, like at the FTC or whatever, is there any idea that?
But we know that in the US, antitrust has weakened. You, what you did when you broke up AT&T, that's not something you imagine nowadays.
They just talk about Amazon. Right?
They talk about Amazon. No? That's right.
So can I push a little bit on this idea?
Yes.
Decline competition. So that's based on what data are you looking at? Because the narrative, at least in Bloomberg, or I don't know if there is reliable data collection on this, but the narrative at least is that the big players, like the Apples, the Googles of this world, they are aggressively increasing their expenses on R&D.
But is it truly R&D, or is it R&D a la John Sutton? See what I mean? Because R&D could be entry barriers, these guys. And that goes back to your first question.
But
you remember when you touched me, your first question, exactly going back to what you are saying. You see, I'm using your own argument. You see, you told me, don't forget what you tell me. You told me, you see, you use patents in a defensive purpose.
That's
what they might be doing too. You
I
see?
Indeed, I believe that a lot of patent applications are
exactly
not pure innovation, but higher concerns. But you look at an Apple and Google, right? They have established businesses. Apple has the iPhone, Google has search. These are not under threat necessarily, but they constantly look into other things.
They
have Google Glasses, and they're looking.
But they take advantage of the network effect. You see what I mean? They have a network effect.
They have ecosystem.
So it's both. It's like I am there. I have a first mover advantage, and I have a network, and I take advantage of that. So that already is an entry is a barrier. You see, in a sense. Voilà. You can call that first mover advantage. They don't even need. I mean, to be honest with you, they don't even need, I'm developing a model now with Clino, where you don't even need to put entry barriers. You are just there in a network. And that, again, discourages potentially good people. So in fact, what's very interesting is that you observe that a number of people are discouraged partly, and also the concentration of market shares has gone up. And not only within firms, it's between firms. That means that the not very good people don't enter at all, they're completely discouraged. And those who are better, they enter, but less so than before. You see what I mean? So that would explain both the decline and the fact that you have an increased concentration of market share, which is mainly between firms, more than within firms. And you see all the facts that you have in Otter et al. That would be a way to explain it. So they don't even need to put entry barriers, they are just there. In many places, and that only that has a discouraging effect. Yes?
I have a quick question. So our point is that you distinguish between creative destruction and new varieties.
Yeah.
I'm wondering what is the motivation for that, because I don't see them being mutually exclusive.
No. I mean, they were interested because there is always this debate between Romer and me. I mean, Romer and Howitt and I. You see what I mean? How much is new variety and how much is things that improve upon current qualities? You see what I mean? And so that was the question. You see what I mean? It's not pure expansion of variety. Voilà. So there's always been this debate. You know, is it increasing variety or is it truly creative destruction, and that's very important also for turnover. You see, I mean, how much growth is related to turnover, to entry, exit, or not. In a world where growth comes from pure expansion of variety, like the Romer 1990, exit is a bad thing because it reduces variety. Exit is bad. If you have a Schumpeterian model, exit is good. You see, so those are things why you are interested. But otherwise, you might say, I'm not interested, and I just look at the total missing growth, and I have another way to calculate it. And I don't care so much if it's a new variety or not. But some people also are interested because of employment. If you think it's creative destruction, it might involve also destruction, job destruction, and things like that. So it's that's why you are interested in your own right for where it comes from.
But then the assumption, implicit assumption, is that the creative destruction comes from within industry rather than from potential.
No, it could come from wherever. Someone else from somewhere else could come and. And it's true, it's within products, so they look at particular sectors and they say within this sector, someone else come, he can come from wherever, he can come from somewhere else, and then displace you. And there is a new product in that product category, which displaces the product that you had before. That's how they would do. But you might decide that you are not interested in whether it's variety or not variety. But it's true that it's, the title was Missing Growth from Creative Destruction. It was good to find that it was justified, that it had to do. And the basic intuition we had was when you replace a product by another product, then you are lost. But it's true, when you add a product, you're also lost. You don't know where to put it. But it's comforting. For me also, you know, I have my own stakes there. And my growth models work with creative destruction. I mean, I'm happy that this is truly a creative destruction story. And yes?
I have a small question. If we say that Y is not the final output, but kind of consumption index, would we be able to produce the same thing?
You would say it's a utils, you produce utils. You raise an interesting question, which is to measure GDP. Do you measure true utils in GDP or not? And that is a much deeper question. And that we didn't go that far, because I think it raises that question more generally, particularly with goods which are unpriced. You know, what you should be measuring is the utils. You measure the GDP with the price and things. So we started from there. But you're right, you raise this deeper question, how would you measure utils beyond GDP? So some people have tried, but it hasn't got very far so far. Yeah. Yes?
In terms of sort of distributional arguments, this missing growth and the food, is there evidence that a lot of this has gone in sort of the missing part of the elephant, that all these Wikipedia articles and free screening and pirate are something that is sort of favoring those parts of the population that have seen wage stagnation?
Alors, there is very interesting work there by Xavier Jaravel, J-A-R-A-V-E-L, and he looks at inflation how differently from for the wealthy and the less wealthy. And so I refer to his work. But it might be interesting to mix what we've done here with the previous work that Jean Bellaza. He's my colleague at LSE. You should come and see us both. Maybe we can start something, the three of us. His work meets this work, but he's the one that does the most interesting work these days on the distribution aspects. Inflation is not the same for the high income and the low income. And it might be interesting to merge that with this. That would be interesting to do.
More questions? Okay, thank you very much. Now, the next faculty students come here and learn lunch.
And so tomorrow it's